I'm Greg Farshtey, and you're listening to TTV.
Everybody, and welcome to a very, very special video. We are here today to bring you all an interview with famed BIONICLE story writer, among other things, Greg Farshtey. So, say
hooray, hurrah, clap, clap.
Yay!
Excitement, cheer, and fun abound.
I love you, Greg!
But first...
Well then.
Let's get, you know, stuff out of the way, say who we are. Exactly. I'm Messinac.
I'm Vardaran.
I'm LJ.
I'm Kahi.
I'm Venom.
I'm Tenebrae Invictus.
And that is Greg Farshtey. Say hi, Greg.
Hi.
Okay. Well, this is going to be great. Just a forewarning to anyone that listens to this. Just a couple things I want to get out of the way first. It's probably going to run long. We're going to try not to take too long because obviously we don't want to keep you all night, you know? But, yeah, this will not be like BSO1's interview where it was half an hour that you did with them before, just so you're aware. It'll average anywhere from an hour up, depending on how fast we can get through this, if that's okay with you.
That's fine.
And then second... As far as the fan questions, which we picked a while ago, as I mentioned in the latest update video we posted, yes, those were in fact, you know, picked. Everything is good with those, and those will be asked next to last as far as question categories are concerned. And touching upon that note, we have a couple different categories of questions to go into today. But before we do that, if you would be so kind... Could you give everyone a brief explanation of who you are, what you do with LEGO, the extent of your involvement with the things that you work on, etc.?
Well, I was originally hired as the first on-staff LEGO club writer in 2000. And up until April of this year, I worked for LEGO Club as my full-time job. I am now working within the... CMA department of LEGO, which is graphic artists, the novelty artists, and now the writers department is part of it as well. Production, quite a few other things. So basically the creative department. And so now I'm not just working on Club. I'm working on various other projects that come through our department. I got involved with BIONICLE in... late 2000, I guess. The first story bible was already done, already designed, all that sort of thing. So the notion that I created it is actually not true. But I was very impressed with it when I first saw it, and they were already talking about doing a comic book. The plan was to have somebody in New York write it. I started doing some pages just to see if I could do it because I'd never written one before. And I mentioned to my boss, oh, I did like six pages because for fun. And she's like, well, that's good because we need an approved script in 3 weeks. So that's how I ended up writing it. And I wrote it all the way up through, I guess, 2010. And then I got the chance to do the novels starting in 2003, thanks to a very wonderful Scholastic editor named Fiona Simpson. And after that ended, I've been doing... the graphic novels for Ninjago that Paper Cuts publishes. I've been doing some Chima work for a publisher in Poland named Amit. And I've also done Hero Factory novels for Scholastic.
All right. Excellent. Speaking of those novels, this is completely off topic, but I before doing this interview, I felt that I owed it to myself to finish reading them all. So I've made it my mission to complete reading them before this interview. And I did, in fact, succeed, except for your latest one, Mirror World. I was not able to finish that one, unfortunately. But, so, hopefully we'll have some questions about those later down the line. But, all right, thank you for the clarification. Next up, we are going to go ahead and get into the first batch of actual questions that we have for you, and this will be yet more clarification questions, but not about what you do. Here's the thing with these. In your line of work, you probably get a lot of questions that are repetitive, stuff like, you know, why isn't Bionicle coming back? Why was it canceled? Etc., that I'm sure you've answered in many different ways before and on many different places. But our audience is interesting in that the YouTube Bionicle community seems to be on an island a lot of the time, away from everyone else. A lot of them have never even heard of BZ Power or Bionicle Sector 01. So some of these questions may be important to go ahead and get out of the way. So the first one is a big one, and it is, why, in your opinion, was Bionicle canceled? That's the big one.
I can't give you an official LEGO answer. I can tell you that I know that sales had been slowly but steadily declining over the years. 2002 was actually the top year for sales for Bionicle. And, you know, I think you could see even from the sales of the movies that, you know, those were not climbing. Those were going down with each movie. And I think that there had gotten to a point where I think the fan base was sort of taking it for granted. I think maybe there had been some saturation there. And I think the general feeling was that it was better to end it while it was still selling somewhat than to just keep pumping it out there and have it eventually get to the point where it wasn't selling at all. Because if you ever want to bring it back, and LEGO always has the option of doing that because obviously they own it, you're not going to be able to do it if the memory of retailers is, gee, I got stuck with all this stuff. Mm-hmm. You want retailers to still have kind of a good feeling about it. Well, it sold really well for me. And yeah, it was a little weak toward the end, but it's still when I was really good for a lot of years. You want them to have a good thought about it, because if you ever need to bring it back, want to bring it back, you're going to need them to want it. And if you wait and it ends up remaindered, they're going to be like, what do I want that again for? So I think they made, in the long run, probably a smart decision, because the only other option would have been to pour a ton of money into it and hope that you can get it back up to a 2001, 2002 feel. And that's really, really hard to do when you've been out there for 9 or 10 years.
Yeah.
You know, I think that I don't know if they ever plan to bring it back. Nobody's told me they plan to bring it back. But if they ever were going to, this was probably the smartest thing to do.
I, to be perfectly honest, am in agreement with you there. And that's an interesting perspective you have about the retailers' side of things. That's never really been mentioned in discussions of this scenario, as far as I've seen. That's important because Bionicle, you know, people have a bunch of different opinions on how it ended. Some like it, some don't. Some prefer the older feel with, you know, the tribal setting. Some prefer the more technologically influenced feel. But I think that it ended in a way that the quality had not sunk to the point where people's opinions of it were soured. Like you said, it was still a quality product. Mm-hmm. So it's important to maintain that. So I'm in agreement with you there, and thank you for answering that. Next, why were the Bionicle serials stopped?
Oh, well, basically, that's an easy one. My daughter was born.
Yep.
And I didn't have time to work on them anymore. I mean, my those things were always a labor of love, and they were something that I did on my own time. They were not a part of my daytime office work. They were something I did at home at night or on the weekends. And when you have a baby, you don't have nights or weekends anymore. You know, my traditional writing time was usually between 7 in the morning on a Saturday or a Sunday and, let's say, 10 or 11. And, you know, once Drea came along, I was up with her for those hours. I wasn't able to go write because my wife was sleeping. So, you know, I did not have the time to work on it, and then eventually the website went away, so there was no place to post them anyway. But it really was a case of if I had kept trying to do them, they were going to come out really like garbage because I was going to be rushing them just to get something done, and I wasn't going to be enjoying it, and it was going to be reflected in the work. So, you know, that's the major reason.
Okay, that makes sense to me.
Yeah.
Well,
it can be a lot of work.
Yeah, definitely understandable. Well, in that case, do you think, is there any chance that they'd ever be continued?
Well, I can't say no to that. At this point, there's no place to put them official for LEGO. And if I was going to do it, I would have to get permission from LEGO to keep doing it. And there's nobody at work really pushing me to do it because of the fact that, you know, we're not selling Bionicle anymore. So, yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, they would rather that I be focusing on Ninjago and stuff like that, that we actually are trying to market. So it right now it probably wouldn't be a priority. And I mean, I have more writing time now, because I only have Drea half the time, but you know, that time is going toward the projects that I'm contracted for. So, you know, I don't have a whole lot of spare time.
Okay. Well, so I guess, say if you were to continue the serials, would you have any like ideas? What?
One day, if circumstances permit, you could continue.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, if circumstances allowed you to continue the serials and you decided to do so, any like ideas in mind, like where you would upload them? Because, you know, no. BionicleStory.com was recently taken down, and Bionicle.com as well.
I have no idea where they would be able to live. If I was going to put them someplace other than a LEGO site, I would have to get permission from LEGO to do that, obviously. Because as I was explaining to somebody the other day, they were like, well, why can't you just like write them as fan fiction? And I'm like, because I work for LEGO. So, I anything I do that's LEGO related, I have to get permission from them. So, it's not a case. Now, I don't know if they would ever say no. I'm not saying that they would, because I don't see any reason that they would, but I would have to clear it with them, because, you know, they might be, depending on what they're planning to do, they might see it as a distraction from stuff that they want out and they want people looking at. So, I have no idea where they would go if that was the case. I don't have a website, so I don't have any place that I could personally.
Okay. Yeah, that makes
understandable.
Sense. Yeah.
Well, may I offer the threevirtues.com? No,
well,
that.
Well, I was wondering myself. You said, LEGO would be more open to pushing stuff they currently have running. Would you be open to doing, Hero Factory Ninjago serials if they asked you to?
Yeah. Or, if they wanted me to, I would. I have not been asked to do that, and I'm not even sure how much awareness there was of the Hero Factory books in all corners of the company. I mean, unfortunately, I really wish that series had continued, because it ended up being way more fun than I had expected it to be going in, and plus I discovered that I could write an entire novel in a weekend, which was really cool. Yeah, I would get up and I'd start writing about 8 o'clock on a Sunday morning, and I'd write 11,000 words in the day. So I was pretty
good.
A novel on a weekend.
Which novel was that?
I wish.
quite a few of them, actually. I think it started with Collision Course, because I remember Collision Course, I wrote the whole second half of the book in a day.
Wow.
Because they're just action. It's action, 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 action. So you just keep going, you know? Dead spots. So, you know, you just keep going. You just get pulled along. And since I never know what's going to happen next, I get excited to find out what's going to happen next.
Yeah. Oh, Meso told me that one of the latest books of Hero Factory had them going up against like the government, kind of like there's this government thing going
that
on.
Was, No. That was not what was in the books, but I was reading his post on the message boards about what was going to possibly happen. in the future had it continued. Because I saw the post that you made about all the potential it had and the story ideas you had.
Right.
Mm.
But that's a later question.
Okay. So, well, I'm sorry.
LJ, you're up for number three.
All right. Are you able to give out any more Bionicle plot details that went unwritten, such as Velika's plan, or do you not have that information to give, or do you remember it at all?
It doesn't exist.
Yep.
I make the stuff up as I go along. I have no idea what's happening next. that's how I have always written. The only thing that I have worked on that hasn't been like that is there is a non-LEGO book that I was approached about. I don't know if I'm going to be doing it or not, and they required a complete outline before they would talk to me about anything. And I did it and everything, but it was hard because that's just not how I write. I mean,
yeah.
One of my favorite stories that I tell people is, you know, that one of my favorite things to do is death traps. Mm-hmm. And I get characters into death traps. I have no idea how I'm getting them out of it.
right.
And years and years ago when Orson Welles was on the radio playing The Shadow, he was notorious for the fact that he never read the scripts before they recorded.
Huh.
And they said, why don't you read the script? He said, because if I get into a death trap, I want to sound like I don't know how I'm going to get out. He said, if I've read the script already, then I know how to get out.
Really interesting.
Interesting.
That's a very good
kind
of unique way of looking at it.
In that case, there's no chance for a dashingly heroic Toa named LJ to swoop in and save you. No, anyway. All right.
Well,
thank you.
On your life.
No Lee will rip off, no.
Well.
Yeah, I can definitely see how that's benefited you since, like you said, you were able to get stuff done in like a weekend. Like, I wish I had that kind of motivation.
Yeah, so, we all do at times.
Yeah, I can see how kind of like having everything on like a cliffhanger kind of helps you continue like going. It's nice. I like that idea, actually.
Yeah, I had a lot, you know, with Hero Factory, I had Bionicle too, really, but and even Ninjago, I've had a lot of freedom, which has been nice. Nobody is holding a gun to my head saying you have to stick to what's on the TV show or, you know, you have to stick to what the year story necessarily is. I mean, the stuff I did with Hero Factory, yeah, it was tied into the overall stories, the brain attack story, stuff like that. But the only thing they ever told me I couldn't do in Hero Factory was give the origin of the brains.
They didn't want me to give that away.
I don't know whether they have plans for it or not, but they did not want me to give that away. It's the only idea that I ever had that they ever said no to. Other than that, they were great. They would get on the phone with me and they'd be like, oh yeah, that's great. Okay. And you could do this too. And we just like bat the ideas back and forth. So they were wonderful to work with. And you know, things like Mirror World is just totally out of left field and they still let me go ahead and do it. So.
Yeah. Well, it's a shame I couldn't read Mirror World in time.
Well, you know, flying brains that shoot brain bolts. Come on. You can't miss
that. Wow. Flying brains.
Yeah.
Brain bolts. Well, then, I got to read this.
Flying brains.
All right, Kai, you're up for the next one, and this is a big one, even though it was kind of already answered.
Okay.
This has to be phrased this way.
I'm sure you've heard this question a lot, but have you heard anything about the return of Bionicle?
No, I haven't. But as I pointed out on the message boards, that doesn't necessarily mean anything, because if that decision gets made, whether it's for 2, 3, 4, whatever, how many years down the road, it would be getting made in Denmark. I wouldn't find out about it for a long time. So because I wouldn't need to be looped in at that point. So I have no idea if it's being talked about. I have no idea if it's not being talked about, and I probably wouldn't know if it was.
Huh.
Okay.
When you think about it, that makes logical sense, but I don't know why that never clicked with me. Like, it would be being talked about not in the circle that you're in, but in the headquarters, huh? Well, I guess we'll never know until it happens or doesn't happen.
Just imagining in my head right now two LEGO workers like, hey, let's bring back Bionicle. Get Greg on the phone right now.
The dark conference room. All right,
Ben, you're up for the next one. We kind of talked about this off air, but it's time to say it officially.
Okay, well, here's my question. Why were you forced to leave BZ Power?
Oh, well, basically it was a case of LEGO instituted a social media policy because LEGO is very much committed to always being as careful, as respectful of any kind of laws regarding children's privacy online, children's safety online. We try to be, you know, if there's a law, we try to be like even more strict than the law is. And there are issues, there are rules regarding communication from a company to children under 13. And essentially that was the issue, and it affected both myself and Kelly McKiernan, who was also on BCP at the time, that you cannot communicate directly to kids under 13. And because BCP has no age verification system and had no way to institute one, I was in a position of not being able to be there anymore. Now I have done some interviews with them because I could do that the same way I can do this, but I couldn't go on there and answer PMs anymore because I didn't know how old the kids were.
Well,
that kind of makes perfect sense. That's what we'd always known. Hopefully this puts to rest a lot of the conspiracy theories going on about what really happened. Was it a ploy by LEGO because they didn't want him communicating to do all this stuff? No. Yeah, it's just what you see is what you get. It's safety. Now, I do have to ask, do you think that this will be, like, okay, say years down the line, BZ Power finally gets age verification. Would you consider coming back, or would you think you were too busy? Or
no, I mean, I love doing that kind of thing. I love doing the LEGO message boards. I enjoy doing things like this. As long as LEGO had no issue with it, I would be happy to do it. I'd be happy to go back as long as the company did not have an issue with it.
Because I will be completely honest with you. BZ Power is not doing well since you left. It is not doing well at all. And part of it was you leaving, part of it was Bionicle ending, part of it was when they went down for a year, close to.
And BZ Power drama and stuff.
It's not as good of a place as it once was, which is why we try to do our part on other sites to keep Bionicle alive. But,
yeah.
All right. Now, the next question is a big one.
Yes.
This is an earth-shattering, this truth must be unearthed.
I am pretty sure this was settled almost a decade ago, but Greg, how are Matoran made?
Oh, I'm not for that. You know that.
But yeah, our fans don't.
No, there were certain things that it was decided from the get-go that we were never going to reveal because we felt that if we revealed everything, then it would take all the mystique out of Bionicle. And that's an interesting thing that you bring up, though, because I was having this discussion with somebody the other day about Bionicle stories. And one of the things that a lot of people don't know is that when the original team before me, basically, came up with Bionicle, the decision was made that this was not going to be a story that was going to be spoon-fed to fans. It was not going to be a story that was going to be laid out. There it is. There's everything. There's all you need to know. It was going to be a story you had to work to understand. And I have met people who have said, oh, it got too complicated. Oh, it got too hard to be, you know, to figure out. And I can see that to some extent, but I met 7-year-old kids at library events who could recite the entire story from 2001 on better than people that were on the story team could.
I think I was one of those kids.
So if a 7-year-old could figure it out, I really don't think anybody else would have had a problem if they'd actually made an effort. Because you had the encyclopedias out there, you had Biosector out there, you had a lot more reference than you have for a lot of other storylines that people keep up with.
Amen to that. So, that's what set Bionicle apart. You just outlined it right there.
I that's why I feel like if it ever came back, I think it would be very important that it have a core mystery attached to it.
That right there is... Sorry, there was a bit of lag in the call.
That to me is what made it work. The trick is, though, that with Bionicle, you know, the core mystery was obviously Mata Nui and the island and the whole thing. They knew from day one what the island was and that Mata Nui was a giant robot, and they knew it all. They had planned it all from the beginning, which is opposed to something like Lost, where they had absolutely no idea what the solution was when they started the show.
That showed.
Wow.
That did show.
That's the difference. If you're gonna start it out and it's gonna have a big mystery at the center, you better know what the solution to the mystery is.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Well,
yeah,
that is really one of the things which is a hot topic in the conversation of, should Bionicle come back? Will it come back? It's the issue of, do people think realistically nowadays, with the way LEGO handles story-driven themes, it could come back and maintain the same caliber of storytelling and mystery it once had? That's the issue.
I think it could, because first of all, a lot of the people that were involved with it from the beginning are still working for LEGO. So, you know, some of them have moved on to different jobs within the company, but they're still in the company. And I think that there is an understanding of what made it work. And there's also an understanding of what bumps it hit and where some of the, I won't say mistakes, because I don't think they were mistakes, but where some of things that we did maybe could have worked better. Yeah. And I think that if they did decide to bring it back, and again, as I said, I have no idea if they will, I think that they're smart enough to know how to do it correctly.
Yeah.
Hmm. Yeah.
Well,
I think if they couldn't do it correctly, they wouldn't do it. That would be in a nutshell what
that,
I would say.
That is what I would like to believe, yes. I would not want Bionicle to come back and just have it be a shell of its former self in name only recognizable by the brand name. If it were to come back, I don't care how long it takes. I don't care what circumstances need to happen for it to come back, so long as it maintains the quality standard that was set up before. I'm fine with it.
Mm-hmm. Bionicle.
Exactly.
Go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say, if it were to come back, it better be just like this dream I had the other night.
Oh, here we go.
Where Bionicle came back. I went, the dream went like this. I went to the LEGO store. Bionicle was there. It was like, whoa. And they had those bags like they have for the Hero Factory sets now. And then I picked up Tahu. I was like, oh my gosh, it's Tahu. They even had these little collectibles. You could like pick out all these various masks and in various colors. It was amazing. Anyway.
Good God. Are you just kidding me?
You just nerded out right there.
There goes our professionality.
Professionality. It's something I was personally excited about, and I wanted to share it with Greg.
Okay.
Because Bionicle meant a lot
to
my childhood. All right. Okay, I'm done.
Okay.
Thank you, Venom. Venom's Adventures in Dreamland. All right. So next up, that's pretty much it for the clarification questions. And I guess we'll never know how Matoran are made. Never. It'll be a closely guarded mystery. Now, next up, we have some personal questions before we jump full on into LEGO. And to start off with, we got to ask this. How did you get your writing start?
I've been writing since I was in fourth grade. Pretty much. I started writing poetry in fourth grade. In high school, I was doing a satirical underground newspaper for most of the time I was in high school. And when I got out of college, I got a job as a reporter on a really, really, really tiny paper. It was like so tiny that you had to bring your own typewriter. And I worked there for a couple of years. Then I went to another paper and I was doing sports writing there for a couple of years. And then I got a job. My father came to me and told me, you really need to get a job that pays at least five figures. because I was making about $7,000 a year at that point. And I got the job at West End Games, and West End, because of the fact they didn't pay that much, did give you a lot of opportunities for freelance. So I started writing game books there, and then I got the chance to do my first novel there in 1992. And so I did, you know, about 35 game books I worked on. I did three novels, a few short stories while I was there. And then I went into direct market copywriting, which was soul destroying. And I did that for a few years, and then I got the job at LEGO. And so I've been at LEGO ever since. But in a lot of senses, a lot of the breaks that I've gotten have sort of been just a matter of kind of putting myself out there. When the BIONICLE novels started, I was not the one writing them, as you know, and really wanted to be, but, you know, I understood the situation. And when Fiona took over as the editor for them, we were going into the Metro Nui storyline the next year. And I called her up and I said, well, you know, I write the comics. I'd be happy to come down to New York and brief you on what next year's story is, so you'll know what's coming up. And I went down there and I met with her, and she said, well, we want to get one more book out this year, and we would need it in 6 weeks. And, you know, if you can do that, then we'll talk about doing some other stuff. And so that was Tales of the Masks. And after that, I did every single book in the series from then on. If I had not told her and made that offer and gone down to see her, then the odds are I wouldn't have gotten to do them.
Interesting. Wow. What a tale.
What a lucky break.
Yeah.
I know, right? Well, you might have to explain what a typewriter is to our audience.
A type, we all know. Don't worry.
It's a wonderful thing that makes a nice quacky noise. That And I held off writing on a computer for a long time after computers were out, because I love my typewriter. And actually, one of my great regrets in life is when I was working at the game company, I was in northeastern Pennsylvania, and I saw an ad in a newspaper for an auction they were going to have in Kingston, New York. And the auction was items from the estate of Walter Gibson, who was the writer who created The Shadow.
Huh.
And they were going to auction off his typewriter that he wrote the books on. And at that time, and I think he still does, held the Guinness World Record for the most books written. He'd done 600 Shadow novels. Oh. And I really regret not going and buying that typewriter.
Yeah, that's some interesting memorabilia there. Well, you know, there's...
As a typewriter, yeah.
Missed opportunities in life. There are many of them.
The Shadow. I would listen to, like, these radio shows of The Shadow with my dad all the time. Quite enjoyed them. Anyway.
Yes. All right. Well, next up, Farz, is your turn.
Yep. So, what are some highlights in your personal writing career?
Oh, well, my first novel, getting published was very exciting. The first BIONICLE comic, the Toys R Us event we did in 2002 in New York, that was very exciting. Probably my first Comic-Con was very exciting. And definitely, you know, the day I got to find out I get to do a BIONICLE book, because I can still remember that day. I can remember the temperature. I can remember how it felt walking out of that office with that contract. That was a very exciting day for me. There haven't been too many real exciting moments the last few years. It's been sort of a little bit catch as catch can because of the way that but I would say definitely the success of the Ninjago books has been a very pleasant experience, because they're consistently on the Times bestseller list.
Really?
And I gotta
read those.
whenever those graphic novels come out, they will be number one on the paperback graphic novel bestseller list the week they come out, and they are the only graphic novel for children that's on that list.
Wow.
And I think every single one of them has been on the bestseller list for at least a few weeks. They usually are, you know, it's basically a top 10 list, and they'll usually start out around number one. They'll go down around number six. And then, you know, something will come out. Usually it's a Walking Dead something that knocks it off.
Yep.
But, but you know, they're always on there. They are Times bestsellers, and they've done very well. In all the years I did Bionicle, I never had anything on the Times bestseller list. So it's very exciting to see.
Yeah. Ninjago has been quite a surprise hit, it seems. I never would have thought it would have been as big as it is today.
I will never forget.
I do work at a children's library. I work at the public library here in my town. And the Ninjago graphic novels are very popular for the kids there. I wasn't aware of that.
Weekend Whip?
Yes. Yeah.
What?
The theme song, Elder Records. Yes.
They get checked out all the time. I have to continue to reshelve them. So we usually get them the week they come out, which is surprising for my library because they don't get anything current.
I will never forget. I will never forget when I first saw the pictures of Ninjago along with everyone else in the fandom. People were like, ninjas that spin skeletons on motorbikes? What is this? This is the weirdest thing ever. And then it's turned into this monster hit of a theme with massive sales and graphic novels and a movie and a show. It's very interesting. It reminds me of Bionicle's runaway success way back when.
Yeah.
No, it's just fun. You know, it's a fun line to work on.
Yeah.
I'm actually finishing graphic novel number 10 this week. The Phantom Ninja.
Ah, yes.
And then I have a pitch in for book 11, but it hasn't been approved yet. So I'm waiting to find out if they're going to approve the plot or if I have to come up with something else.
All right. Well, yeah, one more thing I need to read because I'm an Ninjago fan. I should read this. You too, Elder.
Mm-hmm.
He says. All right. Well, Kai, you're actually next.
Okay.
This is a big.
Well, we've encountered a lot of people, and like this seems to be a popular idea around like some sectors of the fandom. But I guess a lot of fans want to kind of take over the Bionicle canon and kind of have the canon. I know the canon want to be written on and voted on by the fans, and there's others who want to, like, they actually want to buy the Bionicle intellectual property from Lego and give it over to the fan base. And we've talked a bit on our, you know, on our YouTube channel about how unrealistic that is, but it's a very popular idea. So we want to ask, like, what would your opinions be on that? Like, you know, the fans taking control of the canon and trying to buy the intellectual property.
I mean, first of all, I can't tell you what it would cost to buy it, but if it was Lego, I'd want a heck of a lot of money for it because it's a successful franchise. The other question is, you know, you're going to buy it. What are you going to do with it?
Exactly.
Because I assume you're not going to be putting out building toys. The simple fact is that you're not going to find a market for like a book series if there are no toys out. Because the toys help advertise the books, which is why when the toys went away, the books went away. So that's my question. I mean, I've thought about buying franchises that I was involved with prior to coming to Lego, and I haven't done it because at the end of the day, what am I going to do with it? And as far as the whole canon thing goes, I don't think that I personally would not support that because anything that's going to be canon is going to have to be approved by Lego.
Exactly.
And Lego is probably not going to want to put the time into doing that if it's not a line that they're actually actively promoting because, you know, they have a limited number of people to do this and they have a lot of licensed stuff that has to be approved. And I think they would feel very, very leery about having people they had basically no control over writing official Lego story. So I don't think that's too likely to happen.
Yeah.
The amount of crazy fan projects we've heard, from buying over plastic factories to sending like tons of emails to Lego to see if somehow they'll turn over the multi-million-dollar franchise over to them for free.
Oh my goodness.
It is. We've dealt with a lot of people who think it's a viable option.
I will never forget this one person on BZ Power, and he posted a topic called "The Bionicles Shall Be Ours." And he basically said, just send me money, and just send me all your money, and I'm going to buy a Bionicle. And he was serious.
I'll buy a Bionicle.
Oh my goodness.
He was like a prince from India, except he was bringing Bionicle back instead of giving you his fortune.
Oh, man.
But yes.
Yeah. There's some interesting people out there.
Perhaps it's for the best you didn't, at all that you didn't reveal how much it would cost to actually buy Bionicle.
Maybe that's a good
one. You know how much abuse that would... Okay, never mind.
Kickstarter.
Envy!
Yes.
I would like to imagine that it's all the younger fans that have come up with this idea, too.
You'd be surprised.
It's unfortunate that it's not.
Yeah.
Hey, guys, let's gather up all this money so we can buy Bionicle.
Bionicle.
Envy.
Well, all right. Envy. I believe it's your question. All right.
Yes. Question is, are you currently working on any projects not relating to Lego?
Yes. I am writing two books, neither one of which is something that is contracted, neither one of which is something I know if it will be published or not. One is a Sherlock Holmes story. And one is just something of my own that I've been playing around with. I'm probably spending a little more time on the Sherlock Holmes right now than the other one. And then I have another project that has been sort of in and out of the fire for really a couple of years now. And the reason I think it's moving slowly is that it is a part of a series. They don't publish that many in a year. And so they're not really in a big, huge rush. The last thing that happened with it was I sent them some sample chapters. I have a very good editor there. I sent them some sample chapters, a few months ago, and at least, and I haven't heard back yet. So, you know, they've got other things going on. It doesn't necessarily mean that they don't want to do it, but they've got other things going on. So I'll follow up with her at some point, probably before the holidays come. But, you know, it'll happen or it won't. Essentially, I find that I write better, my non-Lego stuff better if I'm depressed. So, if I'm not feeling depressed, I don't do as much work on
Time to cancel
Ninjago. Probably means that means I need to start dating again, because that almost guarantees I'll end up depressed.
Well.
It generally does.
Well then.
Read BZ Power posts.
No. That's... You're
too much depression.
Yeah, I can barely even look at BZ Power anymore because it's a shell of its former self.
No, not even BZ Power. Go on YouTube.
Yeah, go on our videos and read the comments.
Yeah.
All
right.
What do you do? We do not condone the comments made by Tenebrae Invictus today. Now, LJ, you're next.
Yes. All right. Now, this kind of goes off of that a little bit. Has there ever been something a Bionicle and or Lego fan has said or done that has worried you to any extent?
No, not that I could think of.
Good. Good thing. That's positive.
I'm not worried. I mean, I've seen things where when I originally got on BCP because all these people were running around saying Bionicle was being canceled after the Mask of Light movie. And really? Had to go on and say, no, it's not. And so, you know, I get disturbed because I see people, you know, unknowingly spreading misinformation that's upsetting other people. And so, you know, I try to correct that because, you know, you see that even now. I mean, I see kids hating on Chima because they're like, oh, Ninjago was canceled. Well, no, it wasn't. It's back next year. It's got more episodes. It's got more sets. Yeah. It wasn't canceled. So if that's your reason to not like Chima, that's not a reason.
It's literally what happened with Girl Factory and Bionicle.
Yep.
I mean, you have to try to correct misinformation. But no, not worried. I mean,
good.
you know, when I worked at the game company, we had people who would, you know, claim that Darth Vader was the father of their love child, and they'd send him cookies in the mail. You know, that was.
Whoa.
What in the world?
Wow.
I have a lack of words.
I think we all do.
Wow.
Well, no, we don't have a lack of words. We got questions.
Well.
Insightful.
Alrighty. Then you're next.
Alrighty. So, when it comes to your writing, what kind of traits would you personally use to make strong female characters? Specifically, since you have a, what is it? How can I word this?
Since you have a daughter.
Since you have, since you have a daughter.
I wouldn't want my daughter to grow up to be any of my female characters.
Yeah, because I was actually getting to that. Like, female
characters prior to Lego were incredibly murderous. The bodies were stacked up like cordwood around one of the female characters that I wrote. So, you know, I don't think I want her to grow up to be like that. I've been working with this a lot with Ninjago, because I've been trying to strengthen Naya as a character. And basically put her in a position where, you know, she doesn't need to be saved. She'll save herself. You know, she's perfectly capable of fighting just as good as the boys do, and figuring stuff out sometimes better than they do, and handles herself very well. And in the last, I guess, two books that I've done, you know, I've tried to really give her some heroic scenes of her own. And I think that's pretty much what I try to stress when I'm doing this, is the female characters that I do traditionally don't need anybody. They don't need anybody to save them. They don't need anybody to protect them. They don't particularly want anybody else around. They're totally independent. Sometimes they're that way because they choose to be. Sometimes they're that way because life has made them that way. The exceptions to that would probably be characters like the Bionicle female characters were not as strong as they could have been. You know, Breeze, I haven't done a whole lot with, really. But with Ninjago, I've been able to do it. And to some extent with Chima, I've been able to do it, with Eris. And I've done it a lot in the stuff that I've written that isn't Lego stuff.
Well, I kind of have to ask this, because LJ and I have watched the Ninjago TV series. And did you have any involvement with that at all? Because the character of Naya was handled pretty well there, too.
I have not had any involvement with the show at all.
Any involvement with Hero Factory's show?
Nope.
Chima's show?
Nope.
Wow. Well, that's another...
Have you seen either of them?
Oh, I've seen them, yes. Of course I've seen them. But that stuff is on at a higher level than me.
All right. Okay. That's another misconception in the community that will hopefully have been cleared.
Yeah. Do you, like, when it comes to stuff, let's say you wrote something in the book and, like, it doesn't appear on the TV show, or you know what I mean? Like, something contradicts or some character acts a different way. What do you necessarily do about that? Is there, like, a Lego order of stuff?
It's not generally an issue, because anything that I write for Ninjago or Chima has to get approved by the Ninjago or Chima teams before it gets published. So if I write something that's totally, like, way out there, that totally doesn't fit with what they want to do, then they'll tell me and I'll change it, you know. But before I go into writing, you know, let's say Ninjago 2014, I have the story Bible. I have at least synopses of the TV episodes, so I already know what they're doing. And my job is not to tell what they're telling. My job is to tell side stories.
Yeah.
You know, I know where I can fit a story in, and they'll tell me, they'll say something like, well, this fits really well between, like, episode 4 and episode 5. And I'm like, okay, well, that's where it fits then. I know what's going to happen. And I know when the ninja have certain powers and when they don't have certain powers. So I have to make sure that, depending on where the timing of the book is, they have the right power set. But anything that I'm doing is being approved from concept stage through the writing stage by the people in Denmark that work on these lines. So they're going to catch it if there's something that's way off. If they have a problem with something, they're going to let me know.
Okay. Now, I guess real quick, when it comes to story Bibles, I hear that term used a lot, but could you kind of clarify what exactly that is?
Basically, when you're doing a story-based line, you need to put a story Bible together because, one, the people within the company that are working on it need to know, and two, if you're going to have artists or writers or game developers or anybody else outside the company working on stuff, they need to know what the story is too. So basically, this is going to give them a synopsis of the story, a description of who the characters are. It may have, details on the world. We always had to do that for Bionicle because the world changed every year. In the case of Ninjago, Chima, you're going to have synopses of all the TV episodes in it. Some story Bibles are relatively thin and you can get through them fairly quickly. Some story Bibles are the size of phone books. It depends on who's writing them and, how much information they're putting in. In general, I know the Chima story Bibles are written by the guy who writes the TV series. I assume the Ninjago ones are written by the guys who do the Ninjago TV series. I don't know that for sure, but it wouldn't surprise me. It would make sense that they would be the ones doing it. The Bionicle story Bibles traditionally were done by outside writers that were hired to do it.
Yeah.
And the difference is, with the Ninjago one, the Chima one, there's really nothing in it that you wouldn't use. There's nothing in it that is irrelevant. There's nothing in it that you would say, I'm just going to ignore this part because this isn't important. Yeah. It's all important. It's all part of the storyline. Whereas with the Bionicle, especially the early ones, we used to ignore huge chunks of it because it was just way too much. You'd never be able to tell all this stuff. You'd never be able to fit all of it in. And, some things just didn't make sense to do. So we would just ignore them.
Makes all right. Sense. Was Bionicle kind of like more of a phone book than a thin piece
yes.
of paper?
Oh, yes. Yeah.
All right. Well,
okay.
This has been nice, these personal questions, but here it begins. Okay. Lego questions. We decided to put these before the Bionicle questions for the sole purpose. We feel you've been asked enough of those. We want to diversify stuff a bit here. So, first off, this is kind of another one of those please clear up misconceptions, but this is also a legitimate question I've had for a long time. Do you know if Ninjago was initially planned to be canceled permanently and replaced with Chima, or was it always their plan to only put the line on hiatus and revive it the following year? Because the finale to Ninjago was pretty clear-cut. This is ending. So it was a surprise to everyone when they announced.
I can't really comment on it officially as far as Ninjago goes, but I can tell you that customarily, when Lego launches a line, they have in their mind how many years it's going to run.
Yes.
The difference was Bionicle is the only line. Now, there are other lines. City is an evergreen. Creator is an evergreen. They're always going to come out. There's always going to be that stuff out. But as far as a story-based line, Bionicle is the only one that I know of where it just kept going and going and going and going every year. And there was no set. It's going to end at this point. Normally, with a line, if you look at Pharaoh's Quest or you look at any of those kind of things, they know going in how long they plan to keep it around. I don't know what the plans were for Ninjago off the top of my head, but they normally do know we're shooting for it to last for this long.
Well, all right then. That's understandable. Because like earlier, you mentioned that there were about some of the fan outrage about the Legends of Chima. I think a lot of that stemmed from the misconception that this is Ninjago's going away permanently. And everyone did a double take when not like a month or two after it closed, they said, hey, it's coming back. People were like, what is going on here?
Well, I've had a lot of discussions with kids on message boards about you know, well, why do wines get canceled and why do, you know, wines go away? And the point that I made to them is, you know, if you take like a Farrow's Quest, which sold well, it was a nice wine. I loved it. If you keep that for another year, then another wine can't come out because there's only so much space on a retail shelf. And if you have every line that you've done that you really liked and you don't cancel any of them and you just keep putting stuff out every year, then you can't do anything new because there's not going to be any room for any other new products on the shelf. So you have to cycle things out because otherwise you can't ever do anything new.
Yeah, that makes sense to me.
Okay.
All right. Are any of them? The next question.
Okay. Yes. All right. So, what is your personal favorite theme? Ninjago, Chima, Bionicle?
Well, Bionicle is the one that I worked on the longest, so and I got, you know, so many opportunities through it. So of course I have a soft spot in my heart for that. As far as the stuff I'm actually building, I tend to build the superhero stuff. I built the Lone Ranger stuff. What else do I have around here? And I have monster fighters. I have a lot of monster fighters.
You do? Really?
Yeah, I've got all the monster fighter set. Huh. I've got the vampire capital sitting next to Arkham Asylum on my shelf. So.
Yeah. You know, this is a little what you're saying. What do you think of Lego releasing more Batman sets instead of a lot of more kind of DC superhero centric sets?
Well, I love Batman, so I don't have to, you know, I'm a huge Batman fan, so I don't have any issue with that.
Okay.
All right. All right, that was nice, quick, and to the point. LJ, you're up for the next one.
Great. So, since your factory is still going, and you mentioned earlier that the reason the book stopped was that the set stopped for Bionicle, why, to your knowledge, were the Hero Factory Secret Mission books canceled?
I don't completely know. I think it was a case of Scholastic maybe wanting to put their resources someplace else. You know, I don't know exactly. I just know that we had talked very, 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 very tentatively about the possibility of a book 6 and a book 7. And then, you know, they let me know that, you know, no, they weren't going to do that. So I don't really know what the reason was, but, you know, it may simply have been a case of they wanted to put their resources towards something else.
That would be the most welcome option to me, rather than looking into it further and going like, okay, does it necessarily translate to, you know, set sales declining or whatnot? If it was just a case of Scholastic doing things, that would make me feel a lot better about the state of the line, but when it's only source of consistent storytelling...
Nobody is ever saying to me about it having been connected with set sales. Nobody's ever saying to me about that, so.
Okay.
Cool. Okay, Kai. Right.
Yeah. All right, yeah. To your knowledge, how is Hero Factory in performing sales-wise?
I do not know. I don't get that information.
Okay, well, so you wouldn't know about that, or like Legends of Chima, Ninjago?
No, I don't get that information. That's okay. Stuff that the marketing teams would get. And where I work in the company, I would not get that.
All right.
All right.
Venom.
Yes.
Actually, no, I believe Envy has a question.
Yes.
No, I think you have a question. No.
All right. All right. You're right. I do have a question. All right. What are your thoughts on the progression of the Hero Factory theme and its storyline as compared to other themes you worked on? Like, do you think the episodic nature of the theme is working, or is it a hindrance?
Well, I mean, the thing is, they started out with a very episodic nature of, we're going to do stories that last for 6 months, and then we'll start another story. And now they're doing stories that last a year. And so I don't really see them as being episodic anymore. I mean, Brain Attack lasted a year. So I think they've gotten away from the original idea of it's 6 months and out. And I think the difficulty in a continuing anything is the fact that at the end of the 6 months, the story's over. You got to get the kids all over again. It's the difference between, say, a Marvel event where they have, you know, it goes on for 8 months and it goes through three books and you have to buy all three books to keep up with the story, and say 1950 Superman, where everything was a self-contained one-off issue. Well, that's great. You would buy Superman 124. Yeah. There's no guarantee you're going to buy Superman 125 because there's no continuing story. So you got to go back all over again and basically get the person to do it again. It's harder, you know, if you do a 6 month story, it's over real fast. You know, 6 months goes quick. And then you got to start all over again and hope that your next story is compelling enough to get them back again for the second 6 months. So you're really kind of making life difficult for yourself. If you come up with a really good concept for a year storyline, you got them for a year.
Yeah.
Okay.
That is that makes sense to me. And I guess the next question, which we have, kind of ties into that, but it's something which has always piqued my interest ever since Hero Factory was announced. How complex does LEGO believe the Hero Factory story should be? You just got into how it used to be episodic. It's not so much anymore. But, for instance, in the Hero Factory breakout TV show, I'm not sure if you ever saw that.
Mm-hmm.
They hinted at a larger overarching plot, but during the Brain Attack TV special, it seemed as if that was... I'm not going to say it was dropped, but it was not followed up on. Brain Attack almost seemed like a side story unto itself, and I bet they have future plans for it. But is this some kind of sign of a shifting mentality, especially, you know, when you take into account the cancellation of the book series? It could have something to do with that.
It's very hard for me to answer that simply because I'm not on the Hero Factory story team.
I gotta understand
that. I don't know what their thoughts are.
Well, what is your opinion from what you have seen?
I mean, I would be taking a guess, and I don't want to put words in their mouth about how complex they feel it needs to be.
Understood.
I'm not involved with it, so.
That makes sense, because you just said earlier, as far as the book series is concerned, they pretty much gave you free rein.
Yeah. I mean, I had my little conspiracy subplot going on in there, and nobody ever said anything. I said I couldn't do it, so.
You know, we don't actually have a question about that. However, I feel this may be a good venue to get that out there. So would you mind elaborating a bit on that? Because I saw your post on the LEGO message boards about the conspiracy thing.
So my idea of it going in, and it wasn't something I really intended when I started on the books, but kind of developed naturally, was that Hero Factory, Maka Hero's organization, is not a government. It is not elected by anyone. It is not a planetary government or galactic government. It is a private company. And it is a private company that is enforcing laws. And it occurred to me that there probably would be people in the galaxy who wouldn't be that thrilled about that idea.
Yeah.
And when I started the idea of there being a conspiracy, I specifically said to myself, this is not going to turn out to be run by the Legion of Darkness. It's not going to turn out to be run by Von Nebula. It's not going to be a supervillain plot. These are people who have, in their minds, legitimate worries and legitimate fears about a private company deciding what is right and what is not. And having, you know, I mean, essentially Maka Hero has his own army is what it comes down to.
Mm.
So you can see why people would be nervous about that, especially if they don't have any kind of way to defend themselves. And so, you know, when I did Collision Course, you know, originally I just planned to have it be, you know, ship heading, taken over by brains, heading to Hero Factory. And then I started getting this idea, well, what if they built it to defend themselves from Hero Factory? Because, you know, what happens if Maka Hero goes bad? What happens if he suddenly decides he wants to be in charge of the galaxy?
Which, you know, could very easily. happen.
He's got an army to do it with.
Oh, yeah.
So it made sense to me that you would have people who would probably be not the most scrupulous people in the entire world start thinking, what are we going to do about this? And how are we going to get rid of these people? And some of them are probably industrialists. Some of them are probably government people from various planets. But I think you're talking about pretty serious power brokers scattered around the galaxy who maybe the only thing they have in common is they don't trust Hero Factory. And that was where the roots of that conspiracy started. And my one big regret is I didn't get to do a sixth book, because if I had known number five was going to be the last book, I would have written a different book and I would have wrapped the conspiracy up.
That right there, what you just described, seems like a better plot line for Hero Factory than anything I've seen thus far or heard of. I would love to see that played out in book form.
Would, honestly.
Yeah.
I really wish that there had been a sixth book so I could have done that, because it started out just as kind of a fun thing, but then by the time I got to Robot Rampage, it really was turning into, yes, this is a real thing. And then it ends up really being the driving force behind what happens in Mirror World. So that's why, I mean, Robot Rampage was a really kind of a turning point in that series, because it went from being sort of isolated adventure stories to more of an ongoing plot. And Robot Rampage was a pretty dark book.
Yeah,
and
I definitely Mirror noticed World, that.
Mirror World was darker than that, you know. So,
really?
Oh, yeah. I mean, you know, Von Nebula is all twisted and transformed because he tried to merge with the power of his staff and it didn't work. And you know, you've got basically the plot of Mirror World, without giving too much away, is that they end up, through Carter's sabotage, shunted into a dimension where Hero Factory got wiped out before it ever really got established. And so instead of having Makihiro City, you have Von Nebula City.
Huh.
And Von Nebula controls that portion, that small portion of the galaxy, and other people control the rest of it. And if you're a hero, if you're a person who's selfless and goes out to sacrifice yourself for people, you're hunted down and thrown in prison.
Well,
And the brains end up attacking in that universe, but they're nastier brains than there are in the regular universe. And it sort of ties in with, in a way, the Legion of Darkness book, because Legion of Darkness was a very early adventure of Hero Factory and could have gone the other way and could have wound up with Hero Factory wiped out.
Definitely.
So this is sort of what happens in a universe where that did happen.
That sounds awesome. I've got to pick this up soon. Well, I guess this ties into an earlier question that was asked. If you ever had the opportunity to do Hero Factory serials, would you consider telling this story that way?
Yeah, if they wanted me, sure.
Okay. Well, I'll hold out hope for the possibility of that in the future.
It is pretty interesting.
All
right. With people like heroes like Von Nebula going evil, that would also kind of add to the thing, like, you know, there's a private guy who has his own robot army, and some of them go rogue.
Well, yeah.
So,
Core Hunter.
Yeah.
You know, there's been a lot of examples where, you know, the programming isn't taking. And, you know, I mean, if I lived in that universe, I'd be nervous.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Like, if Bill Gates came out with his personal robot police force, and then one of those started going evil, I'd be pretty freaked.
Don't worry. Yeah.
Yes.
Well, that was actually very interesting, that whole segment, but that actually concludes our questions about Lego, unless anyone has anything else to add. Anyone? Okay.
Good.
Well, then in that case, we begin the Bionicle-related questions. So first up,
all right.
Envy, you get to open this.
All right, so Greg, how much freedom did you have in the development of the Bionicle universe? Every time, I swear.
Well, it sort of depends on what you mean by development. I mean, the major story for the year, where it was going to be located, things like that, all came from the story team as a whole. We generally knew this is where the story will start. This is where the story will end. My job was pretty much to flesh out the middle. And that was mostly in years when we didn't have a movie. But in terms of the comics, the only restrictions I was really under were what sets had to be in what issue. And with the books, I didn't really have much of any restrictions. I can't recall ever doing, well, I didn't have to do synopses for those books. I just did them. And I don't recall ever having to have to change much of anything in those, other than, you know, typos and little stuff like that. But I can't recall Lego ever coming back and saying, oh, no, you can't do this. Huh. And because of the fact that we were doing at some point six, sometimes eight books in a year at the peak, obviously you couldn't just do the main story of the year because you wrap that up pretty quickly. And so I had the opportunity to do a lot of books that were side stories. Somebody actually asked me the other day if I could have any of the books that I wrote for Bionicle turn into a movie, which one would I pick? And the one I picked was Darkness Below.
Because yeah, I felt saw that question.
That's a good story, yeah. And it works if you don't know anything else about Bionicle. And it was creepy. So,
yeah.
I would absolutely have to agree with you there, because, to be perfectly honest, that was the first chapter, no picture book I ever read, period. So that would be awesome.
Huh. Well, we know what Minecraft sequel is going to be about. Am I right?
No? Let's do it.
Okay. We'll see. All right. Well, in that case, I've got another question. In 2005, in Time Trap, Krakua appears from the future to become in a vision. Was this supposed to be a major plot point later in the story, or did you have something else in mind?
Sort of both. I did that without, sometimes I would do things like that without having a real clear picture of what I was going to lead to, but I just did it because it struck me as right at the time, and I knew that later on I would pull it out of my tool chest and use it for something. So that was one of those things that I knew somewhere along the line I would have some reason to use that. And if, because I don't plan my writing, if something comes to me when I'm doing it, I put it in there because it came to me for some reason. And that was one of those things.
All right.
All right. Cool.
All
right. In that case, Kyle. Right.
The next one kind of plays off of that,
yeah.
And it's a big one.
It kind of does. Yeah, I mean, well, we know that, you know, what you said before, you didn't necessarily, plan all the stuff out when you're writing stuff. But several plot points that revealed after the post-ending serials, like, you know, the Red Star being a revitalizing center for Matoran. What were your intentions behind doing that? Did you want to revive characters who were dead? Or did you want to, like, tie it into the journey of Takanuma picture book or build up something?
Part of it was to bring some characters back that were gone. Because I knew that we couldn't bring anybody back, like we couldn't bring Matoro back that way. And I didn't want to bring Matoro back. But part of it was that, and part of it was that, frankly, I kind of liked the whole idea of a zombie story on a satellite. So, and that was really what I was going, you know. So that was part of it, was just because it was freaking creepy.
Yeah. Wow. They kind of warped in the head a little after they got revitalized.
The thing I like about Bionicle, and the thing I like about Star Wars as well, and some other things that are out there, and Ninjago too, to some extent, although we haven't explored it as much, is that stories of different genres can work under that umbrella. You know, you can do a funny Bionicle story, or you can do a Bionicle horror story. They both work. Whereas there are other things that you can say, well, you can't really do too many other genres with this kind of thing. You know, you're not going to do a James Bond horror movie. You know, it's just, that's not what it is.
Yeah.
But you know, with Star Wars, you know, you can do creepy stuff if you want to. With Bionicle, you can do creepy stuff if you want to. And, you know, it's a nice change from what you're normally doing. So that, to me, that's one of the litmus tests that I use when I read a story Bible for a new line is, can you do a lot of different genre stories under this umbrella?
Yeah.
And Chima is what Chima is on the TV show. And it's pretty much been the same in the fiction because, you know, we need at this point to present a consistent world for kids to understand it because it's very different from what they're used to. But if it was around a few more years and established and kids really understood it, Chima is rich enough of a universe that you could do just a totally funny story, or you could do a scary story, or you could do a mystery story. You could do a lot of different things with it if you wanted to.
Exactly. Look, follow the Legends of Chima TV series. Most of us, some of us here do, with rapt attention. I don't believe any of us have read the books. But we're critics of the TV show, but we all give praise to the whole concept behind it, the theme as a whole for its universe. And I haven't actually read the books, so I'm not sure if it's told differently than in the TV show.
When I read the story Bible for Chima, which was sometime last year, I guess, my first reaction was, this is the most innovative thing we've done since Bionicle.
I'll agree with you there, premise-wise. You
know, yeah.
The story Bible was awesome. It was awesome. And, you know, they're obviously very creative, very inventive minds behind this because what I have seen, you know, for coming up has also been really, really strong. So.
Well, that's good.
Yeah, it's great.
All right.
Zombie Matorn. I'll always remember this.
That would be a great story.
Thank you, Greg, for enlightening us.
I never thought of the Red Star.
I will admit, like, yeah. Personally, I wasn't altogether sure of it when it first came out. But
I didn't get to do it in Bionicle, so I did it in Robot Rampage for Hero Factor.
Yep, I did in fact catch that.
All right, Rob. Next question is also Kai's.
Yes.
Right. Okay. So I guess this kind of the same question of your intention stuff, but for Velika being a great being, was there something you wanted to build to with, like, the great beings coming back or something like that?
Well, I definitely was going to go somewhere with him, and I actually had a kid on the message boards who made a terrific suggestion, which I had never thought of, and he said, was Velika behind the fact that the Matoran developed emotions, developed this self-awareness that they weren't really supposed to have? And I thought, gee, that's a good idea. So I started talking with him, and he was like, well, why would he do that? I'm like, well, we know Velika didn't like the great beings by the time that he'd gone into the Mononui robot. So I wouldn't be surprised at all to see him throw a monkey wrench into things. It makes perfect sense to me.
Yeah, I guess the interesting thing is that, like, when I've on BZ Power, I've written some fan fiction, and that's something that I also thought of, in which, you know, Velika was the one behind, you know, why the Matoran kind of achieved sentience and became more just than, like, automations.
Yeah.
So that's pretty cool. I guess, like, the last of this three-part question is mostly I remember when you first came out with the great being, you originally said that you wanted it to be Kapira, but then you changed because you said, like, you know, the thing with the Matoran's memories being wiped in Metru Nui. Was there any reason why, I guess, you kind of didn't, you had to invalidate that, or, you know, you could have just said, I mean, not to say anything, but, you know, like, why the great being could just been immune to the mind wipe or something?
I didn't want to use Kapira because I never understood him. I mean, they had all this stuff about going fast by moving slowly in the story Bible, but they never explained what the heck it meant. I never
understood. That is for you.
And if I used him, I was going to have to explain what it meant, and I didn't know how to do that. So I decided that I would go with somebody who purposely was obscure and drove people up the wall because he never would come out and say what he actually meant. And that just seemed to me the kind of sadism you would get from a crate game. So that's why Velika ended up suggesting himself as being a good choice for this.
Okay. That makes a lot of sense.
You heard it here, people. Right. Not even Greg knows what Kapur means by moving fast, by moving slow.
I always thought that was kind of weird as a kid. Okay.
If you have another question, you're going to ask it.
That is amazing. Anyway.
No, I'm good.
Okay.
Good. All right. Back as Ben.
Yes.
All righty. So was there at any one point a plan for Takanuva's destiny?
Something would have happened, but I don't know what it was going to be. I always assume that when it comes time to do it, I'll know and I'll have a better idea than I would have had if I tried to plan it ahead. See, the thing is, I've done talks in libraries to kids about writing, and I always tell them, don't do outlines. Because if you do an outline when you're actually writing, all you're doing is typing. You already know the story. It's like watching a movie you've seen already. It's boring. The only way for writing to be exciting is if you don't know what's going to happen next either. So I was going to find out what Takanuva's destiny was about 10 minutes before you guys were going to find out. And I would be just as surprised and thrilled as you were.
Huh. Well, I guess we'll just have to chalk that up to another mystery that shall never be answered.
Why were Matoran, how were Matoran made? Talking of his destiny.
Yeah.
Welp.
Well, what does it mean to move slowly?
If Bionicle was still going on, you still wouldn't know how Matoran were made. If Bionicle had been canceled, you would have found out what Talking of his destiny was.
Yeah.
That is true.
What else?
I guess like one clarification on that question.
The heart
was
in your tomb.
Did they actually come up for a reason, or did they just decide not to ever come up for a reason for it, like to leave that an internal mystery,
the Matoran thing, you mean?
Yeah, I mean like did they? Yeah.
No, I mean basically it was decided in 2000 that we were never going to reveal that. I talked to Bob Thompson about it. And he said there are some things that we're just never going to reveal because we don't need to, and it's not going to benefit Bionicle any to do it, and that's one of them. So,
right. We never came up with an answer then. It was just an intentional mystery.
They may have had an answer, but I mean, we pretty much do know the answer, but we're just never going to tell anybody.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. In that case, Aldred, this is a big one.
Okay, this has been this among Takanuva's destiny and how are Matoran made? This is a very highly argued and contested bit about Bionicle. Do you remember why you wrote Toamata Liwa's pronunciation as Lewa in the encyclopedias, while you have mentioned before that you personally pronounce it as Liwa?
Because I believe that the people who were running the story team pronounced it as Lewa. And they were the ones that had to approve the encyclopedia. We always had people within Lego who pronounced it both ways, so really both ways were accurate. And so that's the one that we went with.
Well, I have a sub question for you about this line of thinking. What do you have to say to these poor individuals like myself that for years pronounced it as Lua?
Yeah, oh my goodness.
Do you have anything to say? Did you ever know anyone like that?
There are people who pronounce Ninjago Ninjago.
True.
You know, the way it is.
Oh, yeah.
Well, yeah.
That's not as bad.
It just seems like Lua. It just doesn't sound...
See, it always makes sense to me.
You sound...
You know what? You sound...
Or it's Lewa. It could be pronounced any one of the three ways.
Yeah, that's true.
Thank you.
That was a weird one.
See? Take that, LJ. It's about pronunciations.
Don't get me started.
I said it all this time.
We're trying to be professional here, Kai. Yes.
Right. You guys are both wrong.
All right, you're up next.
Let's move along.
Yes. All right, so if there was one sole thing about about Bionicle that you could retcon or take back, what would it be and why?
Oh, that's easy. Everybody knows that one.
Yeah.
I would not have had a vodka turn evil in 2005.
Oh, really?
I remember being in the Scholastic offices with the web producer for BIONICLE at the time, in an office on the phone, yelling at people saying, "You cannot do this. It doesn't make sense for his character. He is the one who cares the most about being a Toa of all of them. He's not going to do this." And what we were told back was, "Well, we want to tell the story of the hero's journey, so he has to go through this test and blah, blah, blah." I never liked it. I never thought it made sense for his character. I felt it hurt the whole year because it made the whole year feel forced. It should not have been him. If it was going to be anybody, it should have been Mattel. I didn't like the plot of that year in general. And the problem is, and this is something I feel very strongly about, this is one of my soapbox issues. You cannot force characters to do things that they don't want to do. And if you do that, you end up with a lousy story. Characters are not chess pieces. You cannot move them wherever you want to because that's what you feel like doing today. If you are writing properly, in my opinion, your characters become like your friends. Now, if you think about who your best friend is, if you're writing a story about your best friend, and I actually tell kids to do this as an exercise I give them, write a story about your best friend. You'll find it real easy to write because you know him well and you know how he will react to certain situations, how he would behave in certain situations. So it's easy to write about him. Now, your characters should be your best friends. So then you know in this situation, he's going to behave like this. He's going to behave like that. And the book writes itself then. But when you take a character and make him do something that's totally against his nature, you wind up with a story that people will not buy into because they know it doesn't make sense. They know it's false. They know that you are forcing a character to do something that is not what he would do. I was working on a book once and I had to go back and erase 45 pages and start over again because I had made the character do something he didn't want to do. And from then on, he was not cooperating with the book anymore. I couldn't predict his behavior because I'd already had him do something that was out of character. I did a book in 94 where the hero fell in love with the heroine. Heroine died in the book. Next book in the series, he was supposed to fall in love with somebody else. He refused to do it. I tried very hard to get a relationship going in the story. Never went anywhere because he was still in love with the girl from the last book. I had made him fall in love again and cheapened that relationship from the last book, it wouldn't have rung true. It wouldn't have rung true, and that's why it didn't end up happening.
I can appreciate but that.
That's the hard part of writing is when you first start, it's like pushing a sled up a hill because you're just getting to know your characters, you're getting to know who they are and what they care about. Once you know that, you're at the top of the hill and then you just sway right down. Because they'll tell you the story and you just type it up.
Yeah.
Okay. Wow. That is very enlightening. Like, honestly, I never looked at this in that sort of perspective.
That's probably one of the most enlightening answers you've given. I really appreciate this
answer. This.
I always knew there was something off about that year. And now I think it's quite clear as to what it was.
If it's any consolation, anyway. I thought the novelization that you wrote was handled very well.
I agree. Yeah, well, I there were things I had to explain in there to make the darn thing make any sense.
Yeah.
But, I mean, I did the Hero Factory books. I got to know Stormer. I got to know Bulk. I got to know how they thought, what their relationship was with each other, why Bulk could say things to Stormer that nobody else could, what insecurities Stormer had, and it ended up becoming really easy to write about them because I knew who they were. You know, and I understood what their issues were and how they would behave in certain situations. But, you know, again, if you know somebody who is totally unpredictable, who is totally, you never know what they're going to do in any given day, nobody wants to be around somebody like that. It's too disconcerting. and you can't write about somebody like that. I mean, the closest we came to that was probably, I can't remember what his name was now, which really bothers me. 2006, the nutcase. I can't remember what his name was.
Vaison?
Yes, Vaison. Vaison was fun because he was totally unpredictable, but he was supposed to be totally unpredictable. But you wouldn't want to read a whole story that was nothing but characters like that.
Yeah, most definitely not.
And it would be very hard to write a story that was about totally about characters like that.
Wow.
Well, this is like completely breaking from like the format of the questions list we have. But because that one was so enlightening, I just have to ask this. Is there another instance like that that's not 2005 that you went through?
Not really. I mean, there were aspects of the Paraka that I wasn't thrilled with, but I kind of got over it. But I really can't point to much of anything else in Bionicle that I had an issue with.
That's a good,
you know,
I suppose.
05 was a difficult year because of the fact that a decision was made to stay in Metro Nui for the second year because so much work had been done. They'd done such wonderful work developing that city artistically. And we were like, well, how are we going to do this? They left Metro Nui at the end of 2004. So then we had to figure out to slip a story into the middle of 2004 continuity. So it was confusing to begin with. I just felt the story was that story was just too dark and too depressing. And kids couldn't tell who the good guys were and who the bad guys were. You know, it wasn't a good idea. I don't think it was a good idea. But that's the only thing I can think I can point to and say that just really didn't work. There were other things. I mean, there were things that I know people didn't like. They didn't like the fact that Makuta and Takanuba had a Koli match at the end of the first movie. But that was something that I could object to because there was really no choice about that. And it had to be the way it was because we couldn't have a big violent fight in a Lego movie. So
it's funny. We were celebrating the 10th anniversary of Mask of Light recently, and we rewatched the movie and we did a coverage, like a review of the movie afterwards, and it was going to be all celebratory and, you know, let's honor the movie. And then halfway through, it turned into a debate on some of the stuff in the movie. Like a holy
fight. This is far as my fault. I suggested a much, I think this is a bit too dark for Lego, but I suggested an ending in which Makuta appeared as he did in 2001 as like a Matoran of a Howl, and he pretended to be Jawler and kind of taunt Takua that way. It was after he died. It was very dark and kind of.
Well, that's why Time Trap has such a soft spot for it, because it was my opportunity to take him from being, I am the uber terrible supervillain who will always threaten you with horrible things and then I'll lose in 5 minutes. turn him into I always have 27 plans going at one time, and I will let you think you beat me so that you won't know about the one I'm really pursuing. And that was when I thought he became a truly dangerous villain, because you never actually knew if you beat him or if he just let you beat him.
Mm-hmm. And
that just made him so much more interesting of a character. I thought that's why I love that book. I got to do a story with very few characters in it, which was rare in Bionicle. Yeah. And I got to really start to explore him as a villain and how manipulative he was and how far ahead he thought. He really was a chess player. I mean, he was a chess player, and he forced the Toa into a position of constantly reacting to what he was doing. He was always in control. And that made him a really, really, really interesting character to write for.
Yeah, all right. Well, I guess just the final thing to say before we close is, taking into account all that you've said about 05, I kind of have to look at that year in a new light, because I'll be honest, it was my least favorite Bionicle year. But I kind of have to adopt the mindset I have with 2010. For what the limitations were placed on it, I think it was handled well. Because from what it sounds like, there was only really so much you could do with it. And if you had those limitations, I think you did very well, all things considered. on both years.
2010 was a challenge, certainly.
Yeah.
Not so much because of limitations, but just because you were kind of grieving, you know, about it. And it made it hard to write.
It's like, wow, I'm being forced to end my story.
Yeah.
But, yeah, we can understand that.
Definitely.
I wanted to say that I really appreciate how passionate you are about the characters that you write about.
Yeah.
Well, right. I take them very... If you don't feel any connection to them at all, then you're doing your reader a disservice. I had a friend once who... He was writing his first novel, and he would be up all night pacing and sweating and pacing and pacing and pacing, and I am not writing anything. And I talked to him about it, and it turned out it was because he basically was trying to force his characters to do things that they didn't want to do because that's what he needed them to do for his plot. Well, that's the problem. You can't do that. You just can't do that.
The thing is, you will discover if you create a character that you really, really, really feel close to, he will pop up in later books, even if you're not writing a book about him. There's a wonderful anecdote in a novel I read when I was in high school about a writer who creates this character named Parnash and kills him at the end of the book. And then Parnash keeps showing up in every book he writes from then on. In one book, Parnash shows up as St. Bernard. He just keeps showing up, and it finally ends up that the writer ends up in a mental institution because he can't get away from Parnash.
Wow. Well, then.
And I have written books that that have characters in them that are from books that I wrote in 94. I can tell it, you know, it's the same people. They're totally different worlds, totally different identities, and, you know, not at all the same person. But I can tell it's the same basic person coming back.
Most definitely. All right, well, that was a whopper of a question. But I thank you for answering all of that. That was interesting. And we actually have but two more in the Bionicle section. And this next one...
YouTube fan questions, and we're almost done.
Yep. So this next one... This is a question which a lot of people have some misconceptions about, and I myself am not really clear on the answer, because that whole period of time sounds like it was very confusing behind the scenes. Was Hero Factory, like the concept behind the theme itself, developed immediately after they decided to cancel Bionicle? Like, did the process begin immediately to find a replacement line? And also, were the stars proposed before or after Hero Factory was created, concept-wise?
Stars, I really don't remember, but I do know that when I had flown out to Billund for a meeting about the 2010 movie, and that was when we were told that it was being canceled. How long before that the decision had been made, I do not know, but that's when the story team was told. And we were there for another few days, and what we were tasked to do was to start coming up with ideas for what could be the next buildable action figure line. And lots of different people came up with lots of different ideas, and one of the ideas that came out of that week was what ended up becoming Hero Factory.
Interesting.
And they tested a bunch of those ideas, and I guess Hero Factory must have done the best of them. And that's what they ended up developing. I was not really involved at all with the development at that point because I was basically finishing off Bionicle and kind of didn't want to be involved with something else so soon. So, you know, the long and short of it is that it was not developed before a decision was made to
Yes.
end Bionicle. It was developed after. So there was no connection as far as one being ended and one starting, other than that we had to have a buildable action figure line on the shelves.
Yeah. Well, this is probably a no question, but I have to ask it because that piqued my interest. Do you think at some point, you know, you'd ever be able to share some of those other proposed ideas for replacement lives? Because those sounded just
I don't remember them. I mean, think I came up with one or two, but I was frankly so grief-stricken that week that I really don't even remember what they were, and I really wasn't paying much attention to what anybody else was coming up with. So.
I can understand that.
Yeah. All right.
Well.
So.
All right.
Shall we ask the next question?
Well, I think Kai has something to interject with it real quick. Well,
yeah, I was wondering about the stars. How did you choose the sets that were included in the stars line?
I had nothing to do with that, so I don't know.
Okay.
Okay. All right.
Well.
Okay.
Envy, you're next.
Last question. Do fan revival projects have any real influence on Bionicle or any other franchises being brought back? Or does LEGO just rely on market research?
That's not really something I can answer because the decisions to bring lines back are made at a very, very high level in Denmark. And I really don't know what factors they're paying attention to. I mean, I think that they know that there's still an enthusiastic fan base for things like Bionicle. And I'm sure that plays some part in it because if what you had online was everybody going, I hate this, don't bring it back, I think that would have some impact. But it's obviously, you know, you're not going to make your decision necessarily based on that because it's just one factor. I mean, there's other factors you have to look at before you're going to make a decision like that. I mean, obviously, LEGO has a history of bringing lines back. Even if it's not the exact same line, it might be the same genre. So it's not like they have not done that before, but you don't just go based on audience demand, because we used to see on BZ Power a lot of audience demand, but then we'd have the same kids admitting if they didn't buy any sets.
Exactly.
And it's like, well, but, you know, if you're not going to buy sets, then you're not helping the line any, you know, at the end of the day. So, you know, you need to look at what the market wants, whether there's a niche for it still. Are you going to be able to do it as well or better as you did it the last time? You know, you don't want to bring it back and have it be a disappointment. And that applies to any line that you're going to do. Is there going to be enough novelty to it? Are the kids you're aiming at, the 9 and 10 and 11 year olds today, the same or different than they were in 2001? And how do you have to market it differently to these kids because they are doing totally different things with their time than the kids in 2001 were doing? There's a lot of factors you have to take into account to make sure that something is going to work. You know, what's the name recognition like? Is there still name recognition for the brand or not? There's an awful lot you got to look at.
Oh. Yeah.
That's very enlightening.
We have paused to let that all soak in. Look how he ask this question real quick.
Well, all right. I keep interjecting here. When it comes to a lot of people trying to do petitions in order to bring Bionicle back, recently there was a petition to start sending a lot of emails to LEGO employees. Do you think that's a viable way at all to send?
I don't think it's necessary because I can tell you right now that the people who run the product development side of LEGO are already aware of the fact that there are fans that want it back. They don't need to see a petition to know that. So I don't think that it's necessary to do because it's not like that's going to be news to LEGO.
Yeah.
You know, customer service knows how many people call up and ask for Bionicle, how many people were doing it in 2010 and 2011 and 2012. You know, they know what's on the message boards. They know from focus groups when they test other lines, you know, they hear all these things already. They already know whether there is a market that's asking for it or not. So I really think petitions are just frosting on a cake, and it's not necessary to do.
And let's be real here. I've long since said that it's a lot easier when you want something back to put a, you know, sign a name on a petition than it is to actually go purchase a set, which is really what would matter in the long run. Like you said earlier, people saying bring it back and then they don't buy the sets. People talk like, you know, oh, well, this will make a difference if we do this. And yes, it does show the obvious, like you said, but Lego sells sets, not stories. I forget if you said that or if it was someone else, but that's a quote which rang true with me. It's important for the sets to do well. All right. Well, that is all for the Bionicle questions that we have. So next up, we have got a bunch of fan-submitted questions, most of which involve begging. Most of which involve begging for the Shadowed One's name, and we want to spare you that pain. So we've picked six other questions that you could actually answer. So, yeah, we know the score with that, and I think our fans do too. It will not happen. The Shadowed One's name will not be revealed.
That was it. None of your business.
Yeah. Wait, can we at least know what the Shadowed One's name
is?
No!
No.
No.
So. It can be like TTV exclusive knowledge. No, I'm kidding. Anyway.
All right. So the first question we have is from Nikon Aquamagna 2. And this question is, did the higher-ups at LEGO ever give you a hard time for making elements of Bionicle's story too dark and or adult?
No. There were times that I felt that maybe I'd made things a little too dark. But, you know, everything that I did was read by the Bionicle team and read by LEGO licensing. And if they had issues with stuff, they, believe me, they would have come back and said, change it. There was maybe one book that I did where I said, oh, you know, I think this is a little bit too far. And I kind of dialed it back after that. But no. I mean, I try to respect the LEGO violence guidelines all the time. And you know, to live within the tone that was set by the artwork and the tone that was being set by the animations and you know, to take my cue from that. We had years that were sort of light and cheery a little bit, like 2001 was, and then we had years like 2007 that were not light and cheery, and so the fiction was not going to be light and cheery. But no, I can't recall ever getting any pushback like that.
I seem to recall reading somewhere, I forget if it was on BZ Power during a question, that you wanted to have Mata Nui rip open the Makuta robot's chest at the end of the Bionicle story, and that was turned down?
I don't remember, to be honest with you.
Huh. Okay. Well, that is the score, everyone. No, this never really happened.
That would have definitely been interesting.
Yeah. I'm fine with what we got personally with the asteroid and whatnot, but hey.
You took my universe, I take your heart. No.
I guess this is like the whole recurring thing which has happened in this interview is, see, we actually had a list prepped, and it seems like we keep getting inspiration to ask these secondary questions in response to what you're saying, and I just got one of those moments of inspiration. And
go
that is,
it.
I just gotta
We're,
ask,
done it enough
I gotta ask this real quick. Were you involved in the Mata Nui saga at all?
What Mata Nui saga?
The Mata Nui saga, the one in 2010, the one on Bionicle.com with Michael Dorn.
No.
No?
Okay. No.
Because the thing about Makuta's death, it reminded me how in that it was drastically different than what was in the comics. Instead of being smashed by the piece from Aquamagna, Mata Nui grabbed Makuta and shoved him up into Boda Magna, and his head was crushed. And that unto itself was a little bit more violent than what was in the comics. But
Mata Nui, bye-bye.
The problem with that is then you actually have Mata Nui killing his enemy.
Exactly.
And you really can't do that. I would not have done that simply because my heroes don't kill. So.
Yeah.
There you go.
All right. Okay. Fan question number two, you take this far.
Yeah. Okay, so this next question. Now, this we've kind of sort of answered this throughout our other questions, but I guess we can kind of emphasize the second half of it. But from Warbuilder 5426, how did you get the opportunity to write for LEGO, and what would you recommend aspiring writers to do if they want to get their stories and ideas out and well-known?
Well, I mean, I got the opportunity to go to LEGO because I answered an ad, basically. Yep. I was looking for a job in Connecticut at the time because the woman I was dating at the time was moving to Connecticut. And I saw an ad online for the LEGO job and applied for it. And, you know, fortunately, because I had done direct marketing and I had done game design, I kind of had the right mix of skills for it. The hard part, I mean, in some ways it's much easier to get your stories out now because of the web, because you can always post them on a blog or post them someplace. But the challenge with actually getting published is the fact that if you haven't been published before someplace, it's hard to get your foot in the door. And a lot of times, you know, I mean, everything that I do, almost everything I have done has been work for hire. It's when somebody came to me and said, we want to do this book and we want you to do this book. And so it wasn't me writing a book and having to go sell it to somebody. If I finish one of these books that I'm working on that's mine, I'm going to have to go get an agent. And I'm going to have to get the agent to sell the book for me. Because even though I've had like 80-something books published, doesn't matter. Publisher's going to want to talk to an agent, not me. So, you know, it's very challenging for a first-time writer to get published. And one of the things that I had always heard is if you write a book and you want to sell the book, then you need to go write another book because they want to know that you're good for more than one book. If you're only going to be good for one book, they're not going to make enough money off of you to be worth their time to represent. So they want to see that you can write two books. Doesn't have to be in the same series, doesn't have to be the same genre, but they want to see that you got more than one book in you.
Interesting. Yeah, it always seemed like publishing was like the most daunting like kind of thing when it comes to writing. It's like I could sit down and kind of have an idea of like a book in mind, but then it's like it's cool, I can come up with a story, but how do I get that out there? It's like
you've also got to look at what the market is. I mean, children's fiction is still a pretty rich market. You can still, you know, there's still a lot of demand for children's books. But, you know, what I'm trying to write, the other stuff I'm trying to write on my own are not children's books. So I don't have any idea what the market for them would be. I mean, I have friends within the publishing industry, but they generally work in children's fiction. So I don't know how much help they're going to be able to be. But I'm writing it because it's fun, because I want to find out how the story ends, and it's a nice break from writing basically the same kind of stuff all the time. I mean, I've been writing LEGO stuff for 13 years, and LEGO is a wonderful place to work. It's a wonderful place to write for. But you know, it's the best thing you can do sometimes is to do some other kinds of stuff to keep yourself fresh for what you're doing the rest of the time.
Yeah.
That's good advice.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Thank you.
Real quick. When you're talking about before, you said you were in game design before you went to LEGO. What game was that?
I worked for a role-playing game company for 7 years. And we did the Star Wars role-playing game. We did Indiana Jones. We did Shatter Zone and Blood Shadows, which I was both involved in designing those. We did a lot of different licensed stuff. We did Paranoia was one of the games that we did. But Star Wars was easily our best seller.
Huh. That's interesting.
Interesting.
Some nice insight. Cool. Yeah.
All right. Alda, you take the next question.
Awesome. This comes from Imposter Gur 007. What were your major inspirations when working on BIONICLE?
I don't know that I really had major inspirations. I mean, the stories sort of suggested themselves in a lot of ways. And of course, the main story for the year was already decided. You know, you had parameters you're working in because you had a location you had to use, you had characters you had to use. So in that sense, it was already decided for you. You know, I usually just tell people, well, I've been reading comic books for 43 years. And, you know, you do learn something at some point about plotting and about stories and about how to tell stories from doing that. And so I think that that comes to be part of it. And part of it, too, is, you know, just it can be something as simple as what music you're playing when you write. The first novel I ever did was a science fiction novel. And I'm not good at writing science fiction because I don't like to write about tech. And so I decided to write it as a Western. So the whole time I was writing the book, I was playing the soundtracks from Clint Eastwood's spaghetti westerns. that was really
That's pretty cool, actually. Science fiction western. Cool.
Did they make you feel lucky?
Well,
before that,
I'm sorry.
You feeling lucky, Greg?
All right. Well, Kahi, you get the next one.
Okay. This is from Dr. BZR1, and he says, "Hey, Greg, big fan of your writing here. I think you even had an influence on my own ideas. Anyway, do you still have the material for Invasion? If so, could it be uploaded at some point?"
Oh no, I don't have any of that anymore.
No.
That was two computers ago.
Oh shit.
Oh, man. I don't know how that is. Oh man.
Yep. We all know how that is.
That's a shame. That book that's like another case of the Hero Factory books, except on a much less bad scale, because you know, at least the books we did get after Invasion were good, but that had a lot of interesting ideas. I wish that could have been at least. But hey.
Yeah.
All right. We're moving through these. Vin, you get the next one.
Alrighty. This question is from Dr. Oktoberfest. Look at these names. Anyway. Greg, will you ever show Bionicle to your daughter?
Oh, yeah, it's possible if she's interested in it. I mean, she's into superheroes a little bit. Although she thinks everybody is Batman. And she's great fun to watch, you know, like Justice League cartoons with, because she'll get very upset. She'll go, "What are they doing? They're going to get into trouble."
Wow.
That's adorable.
What's Superman doing? You know, but, yeah, it's possible. I mean, it's possible that I have a lot of the books, so it's possible that someday she may want to read them.
The mighty superhero Toa Tahu.
And we'll see.
Batman Tahu.
I mean, personally, it's something I would do with my children. Like, I would keep all my sets and let them have it, you know.
Bionicle is the kind of thing that
and then lose all your pieces.
That must be continued.
Oh goodness!
Let's not be pessimistic here.
I would imagine that the Bionicle story would be a nice bedtime story, you know?
A nice bedtime
Every night, story. Tell them a new chapter.
I don't know about that.
And then the portal closed.
I don't know, I can
kind of
see it.
Yeah. Honestly, I would just read from the books. You know? All
right. And so Makuta's head was crushed by an asteroid.
Good night, Ben Jr.
All right.
Anyway, let's go ahead and move on.
This is the final fan question.
And then lightning around and then done.
So I'm going to kind of reword it, but this is from Lord Adazai. And he says, given it were to happen, would you prefer Bionicle's return as a continuation or a reboot?
If it were up to me, I would not do it as a continuation, because that's expecting kids who were, what, probably 5 or 6 when it was canceled to understand what was going on before. And that's asking a lot. I mean, that's 10 years of storyline. You know, it to me, that would not make sense, because a lot of the fans who were around, you know, because you got to figure, if it came back, when's the earliest it's coming back? It's not next year, because I would know if it was next year. So you're talking about, what, 5, 6, 7 years? Who knows what if it ever came back? But that's a long time. And a lot of the kids who were 9 and 10 when it ended are not going to be into it anymore. You know? Exactly. So you're going to have a whole new bunch of kids who may not have heard of it before. You're going to have to be able to introduce the thing to them again, get them into it, give them an easy way to come into the story. I don't think you want to pick it up where you left off, because they're going to be going, what the heck are you talking about?
Exactly. Yeah. That's my thoughts on the whole scenario.
That's what I've been thinking too, yeah.
That's what I
agree. And I was kind of thinking that was going to be the case, because you like to talk about like the different mysteries of Bionicle, and that would really be in line with that. Having to make a new mystery would be probably better than trying to continue the old ones.
Yeah, it would have to be Bionicle for a new generation is what I think.
Would you ever... Yeah, go on.
I guess a branch off from that was like... not necessarily a reboot, but maybe like a spin-off series. So it's like it uses the Bionicle like name and kind of lore, but it's not really directly connected to the previous universe. That could be. I feel like another thing has done that before, but I can't wrap my mind around what it was.
Yeah, someone tried to do that a while ago, but they didn't get the names approved by LEGO. But I guess that kind of ties into my question. Like, would you rather it had to be like a hard reboot, like, you know, 2001 again? You still have, you know, like the Toa, and they do different stuff. Or do you want like more conceptual reboot where it's like all new characters and all new setting, you know, like,
well, so again, it wouldn't be like, I feel like if it ever came back, you're going to have a mix of old fans and new fans. You might have more new fans than old fans, but you're going to have some old fans. If you just start up, basically start the same story again, that's going to bore the heck out of the old fans. So I don't think you want to do, I think that you need to do new stuff. But again, I won't be the one that makes that decision. I might, if they ever decide to do it again, I might or might not get to make a recommendation, but I would not be the one making the decision. But I think from a marketing standpoint, it doesn't make sense to do it in such a way that A, you're going to make an obvious comparison between what you did before. And B, you know, that it's going to feel like a retread to the kids who were around before. So
exactly.
I think it needs to be new and improved.
Like a Transformers movie. That's good.
In all of the debates that has been had on BZ Power and elsewhere about this issue, that's kind of been my personal belief as well, because it seems like a common thought process of many of the, you know, people in the Bring Back Bionicle movement, that we need to bring back Bionicle and it needs to be on Spherus Magna, and they need to make sense of the Batera and Toa Tuyet.
Because they want the story back.
Yes.
They're not thinking in terms of the set cell.
Exactly.
They're just thinking in terms of, I want to see what the next part of the story is. Well, but the story is here to support the set sales.
Yes, exactly.
You know, the story is not supposed to exist in a vacuum. So, you know.
Yeah.
All right. Well, that ends the fan questions submitted to us in the comments. We hope that the lucky six that were picked feel good about themselves now. Because now we get to move.
We hope you feel good because you were lucky.
You were very
all you other people. I hope you feel terrible.
Especially you, shadowed one, guys.
I did want to throw in one more comment on that last question. It could be that they do have bringing back the sets in mind alongside with the story, but they're just not considering the whole process of that.
Not seeing the big picture.
Like I said, you have
exactly.
How many years are going to have gone by between its ending and whatever you do in the future, if you do something in the future? How many years are going to have gone by? What is the age of the kids who were fans in 2010 at that point? And how many of them are still going to be around?
Yeah.
Yep.
don't know. Personally, when Bionicle went away, the main thing I did, the primary thing I cared about was the sets, mostly because I knew the start and the story was going to be continued. But I guess it's just a nostalgia factor for me. When I would just walk into the store, get a Bionicle set, and then search up the character online, go and learn about them.
Yeah. That's kind of what Bionicle had that was unique over the other themes, like was mentioned earlier. You had to work to understand it, but when you did, it was rewarding.
Yep. So. Yep.
LJ, I believe you have one last thing to ask before we move on.
Yeah, and this is the last question before the lightning round. Following the trend of LEGO lines nowadays, you mentioned earlier that Bionicle is more of a theme that you had to work to understand. Recently, it seems like themes have kind of been moving in the direction of more child-friendly, more easy to understand, it, kind of like the Chima and Ninjago TV shows. If Bionicle was to return in a recent amount of time, like between 4 to 5 years, do you feel it would follow that trend instead of what it once was?
It's hard for me to predict. I mean, the thing to keep in mind with Bionicle, though, that's different from, like, Chima, is that Bionicle was always intended to be aspirational. The idea was you write something for a 10 and 11 and a 12-year-old to enjoy, and then the 7, 8, 9-year-old wants it because it's something that a 10, 11, and 12-year-old is into. If you write it for the 7, 8, 9-year-old, you're not going to get the 10, 11, 12-year-old.
I love it. Mm-hmm. You've just perfectly encapsulated everything I've been thinking for years. It's easy to make a theme that appeals to the older crowd that the younger people want to get into. It doesn't work vice versa.
I love it. No, it doesn't. And one of the things I was told once by somebody I respect a lot was you have to pick your audience. Now, your audience could be 7-year-olds. That's fine. Your audience could be 11-year-old. That's okay, too. But you need to pick an audience and aim at them because you can't get the whole group. And if you try to hit both, you're not going to get either one.
Exactly.
Nintendo could learn from that.
Nintendo.
Yes.
Well. All right. It is time for the final group of questions.
Yeah.
And these are the lightning round. Now, these questions are, a lot of them are simple yes-nos, but a lot of them are, you know, favorite blank.
Yeah, so, just quick answer questions, just a little thing.
If you want to elaborate, you can, but you also do not have to. So first of all, what is your favorite food?
Shrimp.
Okay.
Seafood. Shrimp.
Nom yes. Nom.
All right. What is your favorite hobby besides writing?
Favorite hobby? Gee, I have an awful lot of them. it's kind of hard to nail a favorite. I mean, I do a lot of reading. I do a lot of piano playing. I like to cook. Those are probably the top three right now.
Awesome.
All right.
Kai?
Nope, then.
Oh, wow. I'm out of
Games. Yeah. Favorite Bionicle set?
Well, I'm going to lean toward Karzani because even though it wasn't necessarily the most beautiful set we ever did, it was the only one that was done from a character that I created.
Ah.
Wow.
You created the Karzani character? I didn't even know that.
Karzani was my character that I created for the books. He wasn't a part of regular main story.
Yeah. So. I should have figured
that's really cool.
Yeah, I'm glad I still have that set put together.
I'm sad I never got that set, but I will want
that. I will get that set.
Yeah, that set's a lot more special then. That's interesting. Cool.
Alrighty. All right. How about your favorite LEGO set just in general?
From System.
System, yes.
Well, you know, there's so many good ones every year. I can remember different ones that I had an enormous amount of pleasure building. The original Sopwith Camel and the Fokker plane that they had out in like 2001, I think it was, or 2000, might have been 2002, 2003, somewhere in there. I built those. Those were early ones that I built. I love building those. The Vampire Castle, the recent one, that was a really fun build. Right now I'm building the Bat Cave. I'm not far enough along in it to know what that set's going to be like yet.
Okay.
And also I enjoyed, you know, doing the Eiffel Tower. I like sets that have lots and lots of pieces and take a long time to build.
Yeah, I find that it's like the experience that you're paying for more so than like the final piece. I like spending a lot of time building stuff. So the more complicated, the better.
Personally, that's my thing as well, which is ironic because I'm a Hero Factory fan and a lot of the sets with that are, well, yeah.
All right. A little more simpler, but yeah.
Next one, go. Envy.
Oh, sorry. No, I was muted. Favorite genre of music, Greg?
Jazz.
Well, then.
What was that?
Classic. Jazz.
Oh, okay.
Huh.
Oh, wow.
Alrighty.
My father would like you.
All right. What is your favorite movie?
Oh, I have too many favorites.
Just name one.
Casablanca is one of my favorites.
Oh, I've heard of that. Yeah. I can.
Alrighty.
I feel like I've heard of it. Alright. Your favorite author?
Let's see. I have a few. Jasper Ford is a favorite of mine, specifically his fairy tale books. I particularly liked Fourth Bear. I thought that was a wonderful book. The whole concept that the temperature of the porridge in the Three Bears cottage proves there had to have been a fourth bear was just inspired. well, it makes sense. I mean, you have one that's too hot and one that's too cold and one that's just right, but they were all supposedly poured at the same time. That's not possible.
Exactly.
So there's eaten Papa Bear's porridge and then refilled the bowl. There had to be a fourth bear. Wonderful book. I highly recommend it. Ambrose Bierce was an early favorite of mine. That was one of the ways Bierce and S.J. Perelman kind of taught me how to write humor. Jeffrey Deaver I like a lot. When I'm trying to work on something of my own for grown-ups, I'll read Deaver because he's so much better than I am. And I'll read it and I'll be inspired to try to write better because I wish I could write like him. That's the only ones I can think of off the top of my head.
All right.
Awesome.
So out of all your favorite writers, like if you had to pick one to kind of reboot or continue the Bionicle story, which one would it be? Which style kind of fits that?
I don't think any of them do.
Well, hey.
Yeah. There can only be one.
Well, no.
Okay.
Three of them really are humorists, and Deaver's stuff would be way too violent for Lego, so.
So there can only be Greg.
One author to rule them all.
Do you have a favorite comic series?
There's quite a few that I'm reading right now that I like. I've been really impressed with the Infinity storyline that Marvel's got going on right now. I went into it not expecting to like it very much, but it's been extremely well written. And I've been enjoying that quite a bit. Daredevil's been good. The current incarnation of the Hulk's been okay. Phantom Stranger's been good. Spider-Man, what they did with the whole thing with Dr. Octopus turned out to be really interesting, so I've been reading that.
Yeah, Superior Spider-Man. Surprising. Yeah.
I didn't think I was going to like it.
Have you checked out the new Hawkeye?
No, I have not read that.
Okay. I was kind of bringing it out. And then Marvel or DC?
I go back and forth. It depends upon, you know, what they're doing in stories. At the point I'm at now, I can't always afford to get everything that I want to get. So If a book starts to go down a story path that I really don't like, I'll drop it for a while until it comes back to something I want to read. So, okay. There used to be that there were books that I would never, ever, ever, ever miss an issue of, regardless of how bad they were getting. And now I don't do that anymore, because now it's just like, if it's going to be lousy for a year, I don't want to spend the money. I'll pick up some other series I haven't read before and give that a try.
Yeah, very understandable. Okay.
All right. The next Ben? One.
Yeah. Have you read the Harry Potter book series?
I read the first couple.
Oh.
Okay.
All right.
Fair enough.
All right, the last one is, have you seen the television show Avatar: The Last Airbender?
No, I haven't.
We always had these conversations about how, like, if they were ever to make, like, a Bionicle TV show, like, there's some cool, like, animation styles that they could totally use from that show.
Yeah, it's very on another, like, elemental premise, kind of like that.
Yeah.
It's like based cool. on... It's a kid show, but you know, it has elemental stuff in it. So, anyhow.
Yeah.
All right. So, as it turns out, that was not the last one. The big one. The You're last right. one. LJ, it is time.
Hi. Well, this is kind of a solemn question. You mentioned a little bit ago not wanting to watch The Legend Reborn due to Bionicle getting canceled. Since then, have you seen the movie or not?
No, I haven't.
No!
Okay.
Well, I will tell you this right now. I read the novelization based off, you know, from the movie that you wrote.
Mm-hmm.
The way you did the Tuma versus Matanui fight is so much more... It's just a lot better than the movie. I'll just leave it at that. It's an actual fight.
Yeah. I'm ashamed to say I've never read the novelization after that.
All right.
That is all of our questions for today.
All right.
Before we close this and give our thanks for being here and whatnot, it's ever since Bionicle ended, and especially since you left BZ Power, the communities... state has not been doing all that well in many different ways, in interest leaving and people departing and just the general state of creativity, motivation, etc. Before we close today, do you have any encouraging comments to give the fan base about Bionicle, Lego, etc.?
Well, I mean, not really, because I don't have any idea if it's ever coming back.
Not necessarily about its revival, but just positive words to keep it alive and whatnot.
Well, you know, as I've said when I was on BZ Power, if the Star Trek fan base had given up, then Star Trek never would have come back. You know, if the Star Wars fan base had given up in the late 80s and the early 90s, when there really was nothing going on for Star Wars, and then Star Wars wanted to come back. You know, part of the reason these things come back is because there's still a fan base that cares about them, that will pass stuff on to their younger brothers, you know, that will keep the name out there. If there's nobody doing that, then why is there going to be any interest on anybody's part in reviving anything? So, you know, that to me is the purpose that a community serves, is that it keeps the name alive, even if the people who are behind it aren't in a position to do anything with it at the time, you know. I was involved in things that people were quite passionate about when I was at the game company, but you know, they ended and there was no community to keep them alive. And so nothing ever happened with them ever again. And some of them were really, really good and, you know, I probably would work now still. But there was no passionate fan base to keep them alive. And, you know, if it's great to have it as a memory, it's great to have it as nostalgia, but, you know, the day that you just say, oh, well, I don't care about this anymore now because it's not out anymore and there's nothing new coming out for it, you know, that's the day that you pretty much can be sure nothing new ever will come out for it.
Exactly. The initial way you phrased your quote always struck a chord with me, because that quote, I'm not sure if you're aware, it's become famous. The Star mm-hmm. Trek quote. It's everywhere. That's like one of the single most defining things you've ever said for a lot of people. Some people have twisted it to mean, well, Greg is advocating for us to send mass petitions and stuff to LEGO because that's keeping it alive. Whereas really, I believe the intent you meant was just what you outlined to us. Discuss it, be creative, don't just look back with nostalgia, but be involved in the participation and whatnot of the community, not necessarily pester LEGO.
The thing to keep in mind is that, you know, the analogy works, but the analogy also has to be thought about in terms of the fact that the Star Trek fan base did not have the web. So the only way they could let NBC know they cared about it was to send petitions. These days, you don't have to do that because you're on the web. Anybody can see if you guys are having conversations about it, if there's websites about it, if people are writing stories or doing art. Anybody can see that just by going on Google. So there's no real reason to do petitions and stuff like that anymore because you're out there. You know, be out there. That's the way you're going to get noticed, is just be out there and do your stories and do your art and discuss what it was and discuss what you'd like it to be someday. And that's being out there, and that's continuing to love it. That's all you need to do in this day and age, because what you're doing is at people's fingertips.
Yeah, exactly. I think that's a very nice way to put it. And I think personally that that's a nice spot to leave it.
Yeah,
so
very nice.
I think I speak for everybody here. I want to thank you very, very much for coming and joining us here tonight.
Oh, most definitely.
This has been fantastic. And it really shows that years after Bionicles ended and years after you've left BZ Power, you're still willing, you know, just because you're on the LEGO message boards and people talk about the newer stuff, you're still willing to come back on a Bionicle podcast and talk to the community. So I'm
happy to do it, and I appreciate you inviting me.
All right.
It was really nice to meet you.
It was an honor. Yeah.
Yeah, it was really nice talking to you.
No, thanks, guys. Nice. And we can always do it again sometime if you want to.
That would be fantastic.
All right. Yeah, how about tomorrow?
Okay. Well, I want to thank you all for listening to this interview of Bionicle writer, Hero Factory writer, Ninjago writer, Legends of Chima writer, writer extraordinaire, Mr. Greg Farshtey. We thank you all for listening, and we will see you all next time. I'm Messinek.
I'm Varnaran.
I'm LJ.
I'm Kahi.
I'm Venom.
I'm Tenebrain Victus.
And joining us today was Greg Farshtey. So, goodbye, everyone. We'll see you all next time.